Check It Out with Jessica Lee. I'm here with Thomas Beezer, who is the VP of Customer Solutions at Okta. Hi, Thomas. Welcome to the show.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
You know, security is a hot topic. In particular, you're helping to secure the identity of the citizens of the world and the consumers of the world, not just like B2B employees, but consumers are now shopping everywhere. So welcome to the show, and would love to hear more about what are some of the innovations you're seeing taking place leveraging Okta technology.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're right. I think a lot of people, when they hear Okta, if they've heard of Okta before, they think of single sign-on for the employees or the workforce. But identity is really at the center of a lot of these tailwinds that people refer to as either adoption of cloud or digital transformation. And, as you aptly pointed out, we're seeing that with organizations of all, sizes and types, including public sector, federal government, state government. There's a big shift to not only, protect the identity of consumers with mobile applications and web portals, but we're seeing a lot of trends where state governments want to leverage the Okta identity platform so that they can protect the elections within their states. And, part of the change is that they really want to have a platform where they have the ability to customize and be able to, use capabilities that come out of the box, as well as easily integrate with other security solutions as well, so that the citizens in, these different states have confidence in the election process, for example. But, everything that we've talked about there can apply to really any organization where you have consumers as well.
Yeah, and I think there's been a lot of talk about the security of voting by mail. And I'm thinking with technology touching everything, helping a lot of businesses to thrive, there must be advancements in a way for us to securely just vote just on the app. For example, like the way you buy things and you use credit card, everything is on the app, on the phone, on the go. Wouldn't it be wonderful if there is a secure way, a way that we can trust to do that? So be so convenient.
Yeah, absolutely. And, what we're starting to hear from a lot of the state governments that, have become customers of ours over the last couple of years is they want to have a solution that, they trust to be secure, just like you highlighted. They want a solution that they also know is scalable and, can really deal with the peak demand that you're going to see on, election day or the days leading up to an election. And being able to give citizens the ability to, have flexibility, whether it's in person, or through a mobile application, that's something that a lot of states are looking to do. And, the other thing that folks can forget about is you often have volunteers that are working the elections, right? And so you want to make sure that you're also able to secure their access to the websites, to the potential mobile applications or the data stores where that data resides, so that you have the trust from the constituents in that state.
I want to touch on your leadership skills. I know you've been with Okta and grew the team from 5 sales engineers to 250 sales engineers now, supporting the renewal reps and also the customer success manager. So Okta has been very successful. So in looking at growing a team, I want to get your lessons learned and tips, because a lot of people out there are trying to grow their teams too.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been an amazing ride over, almost the last 8 years for myself at Okta. Seeing all the growth that we've seen in our solution engineers, or you could call them pre-sales team members in those teams across the country and across the globe. And, as you said, we support account executives, we support renewals reps, we support our customer success managers. And, in terms of some of the lessons learned, I think, one thing that comes to mind is just making sure that you have a really thoughtful process in terms of the types of people that you're trying to attract to your team. Because really, the first 10 people you have, the first 20 people you have, the first 40 people you have that are part of an organization, those are the people that as others join down the road, they're going to be looking to those women and those men, you know, really is kind of like their North Star in terms of what does it look like to behave and to interact in this organization. And so I think we've, you know, always tried to have a really high bar on the types of people that we hire, not just intelligence, but also, you know, emotional quotient, as well as technology skills, and looking for people that sometimes might not check all the boxes from a technology standpoint, but finding people that have an incredibly high aptitude, because it gives you the confidence that they're going to be able to take on not just the solution set that you currently have, but as you, you know, grow the company with new products in the future, you have confidence that they'll be able to pick up learning those new products and being a, you know, a technical go-to in the field as well.
That's a good point you're making, not just their technical capabilities, but you're talking about people as role models for the new batch of recruits coming in. So it's their behavior overall that counts too. One of the points that you had made about aligning skills to the corporate goals, can you touch about that one? I know that's an important aspect of your leadership approach.
Yeah, you know, in terms of the skills, you know, we're obviously looking for, you know, people that, again, they have the technical background, the technical aptitude, but communication skills are incredibly important. And I think, you know, what's interesting is in this pandemic world, it's not just verbal communication skills, but I think that written communication skills are becoming even more important than they were before. I was talking to a colleague just this last week, and they were joking about how their English major is actually coming to be, you know, really beneficial, because we're having to write more and more. And what we're finding is even though we're in this remote context, it's not just email, but if you really want to communicate your thoughts clearly and succinctly and help prepare people for an upcoming meeting, some type of strategy or plan that you have, if you're not a very good writer, it's going to be difficult for people to really have confidence that you know where you want to either take your career or where you want to take the team. And so I think communications is just becoming even more important than it was before. And it's something that I don't think can be, you know, underrated at all.
Let's talk about diversity, because I know that that's something you're very passionate about. So when you look at growing the team, did you purposely try to make sure that not only is there a diverse set of technical folks to join the sales engineering team, but different in experiences, different in ethnicity, mm-hmm. so that it really brings a lot more than the same mindset?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, at a very high level, the line of thinking I have is that diversity really makes all of us better, because you know, frankly, just provides a much broader and deeper representation of the customers that we, you know, want to win over. And it also gives us different ways to think about solving problems, as opposed to, you know, maybe having a very, very narrow view of how to address a particular problem statement. And, you know, for me, when I think about diversity, I'm definitely thinking about race. I'm definitely thinking about things like, you know, gender identity, for example. But as you alluded to, I'm also thinking about the different types of experiences that people have, where they maybe grew up from a socioeconomic standpoint, different educational experiences, right? I think in times past, companies may have thought, you know, if I want to hire a particular type of person, then I'm just going to go look at this particular school. And if they have a degree from this school or that school, then that makes them a shoo-in. But the irony in that is, you know, as thoughtful as you think that might be, you're actually excluding a very large portion of, you know, the candidate population that could make a, you know, significant impact in your organization. And so I think we've tried to be very intentional over the years in allowing people to, within our teams, you know, provide different thoughts and perspectives. And we've also really tried to emphasize as we build out our teams that, you know, we're not single-minded in terms of people that think in a very, very similar way. We like to have debate. We like to have dissent in conversations. It doesn't mean that we're always going to be able to satisfy everybody, but there's a lot that you can really learn from someone that might be a dissenter or someone that might not be disagreeing with the rest of the team, because they're going to highlight things that, that you potentially weren't thinking about before from a solution standpoint.
Now that we are really working from home, it opens up the recruiting process to people from all over the world, really. Has that changed for you, or have you always been having a remote team and be able to recruit from anywhere?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, before the pandemic, we, you know, would have said that depending on the segment of the business, and for us, that really kind of means the size of the customer, we may have been more flexible with location based upon the size of the customer, right? So if it were one of our SMB types of roles, we probably would have been more flexible. Whereas, you know, in what we call enterprise or named accounts or public sector, less flexible is probably a nice way to say it. But I think, you know, as a company now, we really have not only been thinking about remote work, but really this notion of what we call, you know, having a dynamic workforce. And what that's really about is, how can you create an environment now that everyone's working from home where they can not only be as engaged as they possibly can be, but they can be as productive as they can be. There's a great book that you've, you know, probably come across yourself, written by Liz Wiseman, called Multipliers. And one of the things she talks about in Multipliers is that there are leaders that can draw out 100% or more of an employee in a worker, but there are also diminishers who might only get 50% out of an employee or a worker. And now that we're in this new world, we really all have to, as leaders, think about, how can I be a multiplier for my organization? And what that means is giving people the tools that they really need to be successful. And, you know, as we kind of touched on earlier, I think that for, you know, every leader that's in a, you know, a growing organization, to really have this self-awareness to ask yourself, how much emotional intelligence do I have? How much room do I have to grow? And that's something I'm honestly asking myself quite a lot, is how can I continue to grow in that regard myself, so that I can be a better listener, be more present, be more understanding for the people that are in my organization, so they really can do their best work.
Thomas, given that you are looking at candidates from different walks of life with different experiences on that, I'm just wondering, is there a very small core of values or characteristics that you hone in?
Yeah, absolutely. In terms of values, you know, we have some pretty clear values at Okta, and the very first value that we talk about is loving our customers. So, you know, having a real emphasis on customer satisfaction and being able to look at, you know, for example, the candidates that are in our candidate pool as we think about hiring, being able to understand how have they thought about working with their customers in the past, and can they give us, you know, really clear stories of how they've worked with customers and focused on their success in the past? Because in a role like ours, it can be really easy to think that, you know, the most important thing is revenue, you know, in the bottom line. But, you know, the truth is, if we make customers successful, the revenue will actually follow, and the growth of the company and the individuals will actually follow. And so that's, you know, something that we're definitely trying to get a feel for when we talk to these candidates. And then, you know, being that our roles are very technical in nature, we do have a pretty standardized process. And, you know, in addition to, you know, interviews that we have with a, you know, a pretty diverse interview panel, sometimes in groups, sometimes one-on-ones, we also have our candidates go through something that we call a technical challenge. So what they do is we give them a document, and it sets the stage and it sets the expectation that they're going to be presenting to us just like they would be presenting to a customer. And so this allows them to actually get their hands on the Okta software as a service, and then they can select from, you know, a laundry list of use cases. And the idea is to see, how is that person able to put a presentation together with some very limited guidelines? Because we're trying to see how creative they can be. We're trying to see what their communication style is like. We're trying to see how do they articulate value in value propositions to a customer. Because it's one thing to, you know, show a bunch of features and functionality, but it's another thing to, you know, as you're showing those capabilities of the software, to help the audience, the customer, understand how that's going to push forward an internal business initiative that they have in the organization. So that challenge that we have for all of our candidates is something that we do as a group. So we typically have at least half a dozen Okta employees that will, you know, effectively role play. Somebody might play the role of the chief marketing officer, or someone might play the role of the CISO or the CIO, or, you know, a director level person. And the person giving this presentation in this mock format is effectively showing us how they would engage our customers. And that's a really great way for us to measure and get a feel on how do they communicate, what's their level of confidence, how quickly could they turn this around, right? You'll see some candidates that may spend up to, you know, 4 weeks preparing this because maybe they're more of a perfectionist. And we've seen other candidates that'll turn it around in a couple days. And so it tells you a lot about how those individuals prepare. It also shows you about their aptitude. Maybe they didn't come from the identity and access management space, but they're a great technologist and they have a really high aptitude. And so they're able to figure out how this technology works and how they can tell a compelling story in terms of a presentation and a demonstration. So those are some examples of the things that we look at from, you know, a personality and a cultural value standpoint.
Okay, now I want to ask you about something you talked to me about, the introduction of changes to organizations.
Okay.
And I know that you've grown from role to role, and your leadership has now taken you to this VP level. Along the way, you made some recommendation of changes. Talk to us about the process that, because I know you do a lot of research, you really try to deeply understand different organizations before making suggestions, which I think is a very smart strategy. So tell us more about that approach.
Yeah, this is a great question. I love this. So, you know, I think when you consider change management in an organization, you're never going to be able to have all of the information and data that you want to have, right? But I think it's really important to be as thoughtful as you possibly can be in terms of doing your research. So, and I'll just give you an example. There was a large initiative that we rolled out to, you know, our global teams over effectively just over the last 14 months. And this had to do with a particular go-to-market strategy that we had for all of our teams across Okta. And, you know, it could have been very easy for myself or maybe a couple of my leaders to just kind of put our heads together with our assumptions and what we thought we knew and just say, hey, we're going to roll this program out. We're going to get everybody enabled and we're going to do it right now. What actually happened is we spent almost 3 months doing research, doing investigation. And the reason it took so long is this was such a big initiative that we needed to get inputs from the engineering team, from the product team, from the support team, from the professional services team, from the customer success team, from our SE team, from sales, from legal. I mean, this was a huge project that really kind of spanned across the entire organization. And we really wouldn't have done ourselves or the company justice if we had kind of taken that first approach to just kind of push this change forward as fast as possible. And so what we did is we spent a lot of time having very, you know, long discussions with subject matter experts across all of those different cross-functional teams. And then we documented that. And then we had to spend a considerable amount of time in that first 3 months really teasing out what were the themes, what were the commonalities, what were the most important things that we needed to communicate to our global team members, and what were maybe some of the things that might be tribal knowledge. If you had joined Okta 5+ years ago, you might know these things. But now if you started in the last couple of years, maybe that wasn't part of our standard enablement, for example. And so, you know, for us, it was incredibly helpful to put a lot of thought into that. And then to really have a plan on how are we going to communicate this to the teams, who needed to be enabled first, who needed to be enabled second, how would we measure the success and ensuring that people were actually getting the knowledge and not just, you know, not just watching a video, but how could we actually see that they were then able to put it into practice and, you know, see behavioral change across the organization. So, you know, with that example, I think that, you know, it's incredibly important as a senior level leader when you're rolling out change to just over communicate, you know, as much as you possibly can with people about the process that we're in, what we're going to be doing, why we're doing it, what the motivations are, how do we know if we're successful, and then coming back to that many, many times. One thing I tell my leaders internally, half jokingly, but you know, half serious, is, you know, if you really want to affect change, you've got to repeat the message at least 20 times before people get it. And it's not because people are dumb. It's, you know, specifically in tech, we're taking on so much information, so much input all the time, that if you really want to effectively roll out change, you have to communicate those changes ad nauseum. Because if you just say it once or twice, or maybe even three times, people are going to forget about it unless it's something that's really front and center that they know is, you know, attached to some critical KPIs for your organization. And, you know, they know it's attached to the success of their role as well.
Okay. So having done the 3 months of research, you must have then gone back and made a lot of changes to this project, which it's the content for enablement, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So a lot of this did get rolled out for global enablement in a few different fashions, actually. And there were assumptions that we had from the beginning where we did have some of the collateral kind of in a rough draft form, if you will. And, you know, these were either docs or presentations or spreadsheets, if you will, where we were tracking what we thought we might do. But after we did all of the research, we said, wow, there are actually things that we didn't know were as important for us to highlight that we then went back and changed. And, you know, in terms of just enablement best practices, I think that, you know, making sure that you're communicating as best as you possibly can with your team. If you have an enablement team in your organization that's helping you curate some of the content, being able to iterate a bit back and forth in terms of, hey, here's our first pass at this. Let's do a review. Let's see if this, you know, seems right. And then if the leadership team feels like, okay, this is going to be useful, let's then, you know, pilot it with a small number of team members who are individual contributors and see what their experience of the content is. Does it really land? Does it make sense to them? Do they have anything they think maybe we should change as well? Those were all things that we put into practice. And so the content that we have now, you know, it's definitely evolved for this particular initiative over the last 15 months. But now it's part of all of the new hire ramp up content that we have for all of our new hires. And we've also had all of our existing employees go through it. And that's been great because, you know, we're now universally singing from the same sheet of music on these particular topics, as opposed to maybe a customer experiencing us in different ways, right? What you don't want is a customer hearing three different messages about a similar topic from the same company. That's confusing. So we've done a really good job getting everybody really unified in being on the same page. And it's hard work to do that. It's not something that you can, you know, just do over the weekend and, you know, roll out for the next week to really get people, you know, speaking again, like I said, or singing from the same sheet of music. It's a lot of energy. It's a lot of effort, a lot of communications and, you know, getting buy-in from different teams.
Okay. Well, you've been growing, you guys are doing well, and you now have great enablement content for the new hires. You must be hiring, right? Are you guys hiring?
Yeah, we are hiring. So we are growing really phenomenally. our last quarterly earnings call, our growth was right around 40%, which is really exciting year over year for that quarter. So folks can go to okta.com/careers as a first stop. And there are hundreds of positions that we're hiring for right now, and that's globally. So we've got over a dozen global offices. So not just in North America, but also in Europe, as well as Asia Pacific. We just hired our GM for the Tokyo, Japan office, which is really exciting. And then we already have a great team in Australia and Singapore as well. So things are growing very quickly. That is the best place to start, is again, okta.com/careers.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Thomas, for being on the show to talk about Okta, what's happening, some of the exciting security innovations, and your leadership skills and the lessons learned and the tips that you are sharing with us.
Yeah, thank you.
There you have it. Take it up with Jessica Lee, Thomas Beezer from Okta.